going together, turning to the words of Psalm 97, and they're there on the opening page of your order of service, the first five verses of Psalm 97. The Lord reigns, let the earth rejoice. That's the invitation of God. It's the call of God to us all today to worship him. All distant shores their joy make known. What a wonderful thing to think of as we worship the Lord here, all over the world today. In different continents, different cultures, different languages, people are praising the Lord and giving thanks for the Lord Jesus Christ. Our opening song reminds us about the God that we worship. He's the one who reigns, that means he's in charge of everything. He's the God who's holy. Verse 2, fire goes before him and consumes on every side his enemies. It's a picture of God's holiness. And we're told in verse 3 that the mountains melt like wax before the Lord, for Lord of earth is he. The heavens declare his righteousness, all peoples do his glory see. So the God that we worship is a God who can be known, and he can be known through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We're reminded in verse 4 that God calls us to worship him rather than all the rest of things that people worship. You and I were designed to worship. And either we worship the one true God through Jesus Christ, or we worship all sorts of things, because we're all worshippers and we've been called to worship the one true God today. So we're going to stand to sing these five verses, and then we'll remain standing at the end of the singing as I lead us in prayer. So let's praise the Lord.
The Lord reigns,
let the earth rejoice.
Almighty God, we come to worship you today, for there is no other God but you. We come to worship you because that's what you have made us for. We thank you that you've made us different from every other part of creation, that we've got these minds that can reason and think, that we've got a soul that lives forever and ever, and that to us you've given this great calling to be worshippers of the living God. Mighty God, we acknowledge that of ourselves we would turn and worship anything but you, for we are sinners by nature and by action. But we thank you for the work of Jesus Christ, whom you sent into the world to redeem and save sinners like us, to make us true worshippers, able to worship you in spirit and in truth. And so we come to ask for your help, mighty God. We ask that you would come amongst us, as you have promised, that where your people gather, there you are. And so we would be aware of that as we worship you today, and that as we hear your word read, that we'll know that it's you speaking to us. As we sing these songs, these psalms out of your word, that we'll hear you address us, and later as we hear your word explained and applied, that we know you speaking into our lives. We thank you, Lord, for all the ways that you've blessed us in the week past. You have provided for us things for our bodies, for our physical nourishment. You have provided many of us for work to do. You have kept watch of us, over us, and that you've enabled us to be here today. We have much to thank you for the beauty of these spring come summer days. We give you thanks. We pray that we'd be people of gratitude for all the blessings you shower upon us. And Lord, as we stand before you, the holy God who we've been singing about, we are aware that by ourselves we are unholy. We turn from you, we turn from your word, and we pray that you would forgive us. We pray these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Well, we're working through the Gospel according to Matthew, Matthew's Gospel. We're reading through Matthew's Gospel and thinking about it quite some time now. And we're in Matthew chapter 21 this morning. Matthew chapter 21. And we're going to be reading from verse 33 of Matthew 21, reading on into the next chapter to Matthew 22 and verse 14. So that's what I'm going to read for you this morning. Before I do that, I want to speak to the boys, the little boys. You can work out for yourself, men, if you describe yourself as a little boy still, but it'll suffice for all of you. Can you see this picture here? Do you know what type of fruit that is? Yeah, what are those? They're grapes, yeah. Yeah, and where would you find grapes growing? Would you find grapes growing on an apple tree?
No.
No. Would you find them growing on a pear tree?
No.
No. You would find them growing on it's called a vine. A vine's the plant that grapes grow on. And in the Bible, boys, God uses grapes and the plants that grapes grow on to tell us lots about him. In fact, we're going to be thinking today about how God called his people, and he said that they were like a whole garden of vines where grapes grow. And we're going to be learning about how God calls us to worship him and to follow him. And he's looking for fruit. If you had one of these vines, I don't think you could grow them here unless you've got a greenhouse. But if you got one of these grape plants, a vine growing, and you would want to find some grapes on it, wouldn't you? When it was time for gathering the grapes. And God, when he looks at our lives, he wants to find us with love for him and a desire to serve him. And we're going to be learning about that today in church. So let's read together Matthew 21 from verse 33. This is God's word. Hear another parable. There was a master of a house who planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a wine press in it and built a tower and leased it to the tenants and went into another country. When the season for fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to get his fruit. The tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other servants more than the first, and they did the same to them. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, this is the heir. Come, let's kill him and have his inheritance. And they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. When therefore the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, he will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the fruits in their season. Jesus said to them, have you never read the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived that he was speaking about them. And although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds because they held him to be a prophet. And again Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son and sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again he sent other servants, saying, tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast. But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. The king was angry and sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, the wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you find. And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came to look at the guests, he saw there was a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, bind him hand and foot and cast him into outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen. Well, before we come to look at our passage from Matthew today, we're going to sing again, and we're turning to the words of Psalm 80. You'll see it there on your order of service. It's the large verses 3 to 6 of Psalm 80. And this song will help you understand the parable that we're looking at this morning. The song begins here, you brought a vine from Egypt. And the psalmist was speaking about Israel, taken out of the land of Egypt. And God said they were like a vine, precious to him. And he planted them in the promised land. And he looked for them to bear fruits. He looked for them to love him and serve him. But the story of the Bible tells us that these men, women, by and large, they just didn't trust God. They started to turn to the gods of the nations around about them. And God came in judgment on them and scattered them to the ends of the earth. And yet God was still going to build his church. Psalm 80, verses 3 to 6. We stand as we sing praise to God.
You brought a vine from Egypt,
it's precious light.
to stand, please remain standing. If you'd like to sit down, that's okay as well. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this song, reminding us of the sweep of the Old Testament, that the people of Israel, whom you'd called out of Egypt to be your vine, that they failed. They didn't love you and follow you as they said they would. But we thank you that your plan was not scuppered, for you sent the one who said, "I am the vine." You sent the true Israel, who fully and truly followed you and was obedient even to death on the cross. And we thank you that he's been building his church of converted Jew and converted Gentile across the world through the centuries. And we rejoice that he's doing that today. We've sung, O Lord, that you would revive us. We ask that, Lord God, for the Church of Jesus Christ in this city, in this nation, and in these islands. We pray that your Spirit would work in all his mighty power, stirring up your people to bear fruit, and that we might be able to reach out to the ends of the earth and tell the world of this great Saviour, Jesus Christ, who gives life. Give us ears, Lord, to hear him today as we think of this parable that he told and the lessons that you would have us learn. We ask that your Spirit, that he would speak them into our hearts. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're in Matthew chapter 21 today. And if you have your Bible open or the order of service, we're not looking at this whole passage today. We're looking at the verses that are marked 33 to 46. We've been seeing that Matthew's gospel was given by the Holy Spirit to the people of Matthew's day, who are primarily from a Jewish background. And so it's full of all sorts of Old Testament verses and images. And indeed, this parable that the Lord told, we'll see it's full of images right out of the Old Testament. It's a series of parables, a little threesome of parables that the Lord told, especially for the religious leaders at that time. And isn't it powerful? Didn't you find it so gripping, even as it was read to us? It's startling. If you didn't know it or hadn't read it before, and someone just give you these verses typed out, or some of them at least, you would think, is this out of a local newspaper somewhere? These accounts of beatings and executions, a leading businessman's son, he's bumped off in an alleyway somewhere. Cold-blooded murder. It's a really gripping story. And there's a certain appeal to us about this story that Jesus told. The appeal being that the money-grabbing murderers, they got sorted out in the end. We like that. When people get sorted out. And yet, isn't there something about this parable that we find a little bit uncomfortable with our 21st century ears on, if you like? Can be rising within us saying, well, these tenants, well, maybe they were a little short on food. Maybe they had all sorts of reasons that they behaved like this. Let's not be too hard on them. Some people find it hard to believe that the Lord Jesus would tell such a gripping, gruesome story like this. But he did. And it was one of these three carefully crafted parables that he told for the religious establishment of the day. It is somber. It is serious. Well, actually, the message of the Bible, although it is really good news, it is somber too, and it is extremely serious. And the Lord Jesus, he was serious. He was on the way to die on the cross for sinners. What could be more serious than that, than for you and I to be certain of the one way to heaven through the finished work of Jesus Christ? And the Lord was being somber and serious because he loved these men. These men who were his enemies. These men who were already getting together and thinking, how can we get rid of him? And yet he loved them to tell them the truth. And the Lord hasn't changed. And so if you find him poking you today with this parable, don't take the strunts, as it were, but just run to Jesus Christ and trust him. It's a parable that's calling us to build our lives on the rock of Jesus Christ. What could be more relevant for you and I to think of how we're building our lives? And Jesus is this great rock. There's a Bible commentator in the 20th century, William Hendrickson, he said in this about this parable, "It is a parable depicting sin most unreasonable and love incomprehensible." So you can watch out for those two things, will you? You watch out and think, well, where's the little bit that this is sin most unreasonable? And where's the little bit where this is love incomprehensible? Well, let me help you think about this parable today. That's just why I'm here, to help you hear God speak to you in this parable. And we're going to think of it under just three little headings to hang our thoughts. And we're going to think, first of all, about the parable presented. You see, the Lord Jesus here, his love is just dripping from him for these men. Look at how this section begins, verse 33. "Hear another parable." That's an incomprehensible love. Oh, that's the first little snippet of it. That's an incomprehensible love. He's wanting these men who were shaking their little fists at him, he's wanting them to understand. He's full of kindness. There's no hint just now from Jesus Christ, "That's me done with you, man. You religious people, I've tried and you don't listen." Oh, he's full of incomprehensible love. And he tells them another parable. He's persistently presenting the truth. That's a little lesson for you, Christian, by the way. Don't grow tired or weary about persistently telling people the truth about Jesus Christ. It's a mark of your master. That's what he loved to do. And how easy he made it for them. You and I should try and do that when we're talking to people about the Lord Jesus. Make it as simple as possible. And he makes it easy for these men. Verse 33, "There was a master of a house who planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a wine press in it and built a tower and leased it out to tenants and went into another country." Well, that's very odd to you and I, because we don't live in the first century Palestine. But if you'd lived back there, you would have just said, "Oh, I know this. I've seen this so often." It was a common occurrence. It was a very simple visual aid from a daily experience. They would have seen men putting up fences. They'd have seen men in the past digging out wine presses. They'd have seen people erecting watchtowers. And so the Lord Jesus here, with these very graphic pictorial things, he's drawing his listeners in. It's a little bit more work for you, because I don't think unlikely you've got a vineyard in your back garden and you've been digging a wine press. But you know what Jesus is doing here. He's just drawing you and I into it. And we can see it, can't we? And it's harvest time. In verse 34, "When the season for fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to get his food." That would have been a normal thing to have happened. It wasn't an unusual thing for there to be an absentee landlord, someone who owned a vineyard and lived somewhere else and rented it out to tenants. And when fruit season came, he's coming back and said, "No, it's time for my fruit." No doubt they got their cut, but it all belonged to him. And there's nothing improper in the owner's request. It was time for him to get the fruit of his vineyard. Well, it's all very nice, a parable up to this point, isn't it? Vines growing and wine presses being dug and fences being put up. But then the Lord's parable gets a bit spicy, doesn't it? In verse 35, "And the tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another." It's local news or of an inner city or tabloid news headlines. It's a fairly violent response, isn't it? come for my fruit. Some men are getting stoned, others are getting beaten up, some are getting killed. Well, what will the owner do? Well, he's not put off, is he, in this parable of the Lord Jesus, where we're told in verse 36, again he sent other servants, more than the first. Well, they listen to them, won't they? And Jesus said, and they did the same to them. The same. They stoned them. They murdered them. They beat them up. Well, would that be the owner finished? No, it's not. Because we're told in verse 37, finally he sent his son to them, saying, they'll respect my son. And did they? Well, we're told in verse 38, but when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, this is the heir. Come, let's kill him and have his inheritance. Maybe they reasons the owner must be getting on now. He hasn't come himself. Maybe he's just not able to come, and this is his only son. What about this for a plan, fellas? If he's the only son, which is looking like it, why don't we just get rid of him? And then we work through the law that was in place in Palestine in those days, that if you owned a piece of land and it was undisputed for 3 years, I think you can actually still do that in our laws somewhere as well. I can remember a man that comes to mind here, lived opposite us in a house we once lived in, and there was a piece of grass he was always cutting, and it was totally undetached from his house. I thought, I can barely be bothered to cut my own grass. Why is he cutting this grass? And then somebody told me, oh, he's been cutting that for so many years, and then it's going to be his. And that was actually the law that was here in Bible times. If it was undisputed possession, it was all yours. And so they have this plan. Verse 39. The son comes, and they took him, they threw him out of the vineyard, and they killed him. By now, the Lord Jesus' listeners are caught in the grip of this story. Well, you are, aren't you? If I hadn't read it all for you at the start and you didn't know it, you'd be saying, well, what's next? Well, what's next for you? Isn't there a sense of rage? Surely they're not going to get away with that. Surely somebody's going to sort this all out. So there's the parable, and it's presented to us. But the Lord Jesus didn't just want to present things to people. You see, he was full of this indescribable love, and he wanted people to get the point of the parable. What a communicator he was. So wise, so winsome, so clear, so authoritative. Isn't it interesting that the very man who just recently, a few paragraphs back, had asked Jesus, by what authority are you doing these things? And now they're experiencing his authority. They're sitting listening. And they've been forced to see some truths. You see, these men couldn't help be drawn in. I picture them, and they're on the edge of their seats. What's coming next in this story from Jesus of Nazareth? And then the Lord Jesus presses that button. You remember that about the parables? They're the stealth bomber that come in underneath the radar of people's thinking. And then the Lord Jesus, he drops the payload of the message. Verse 40. When therefore the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to these tenants? Can you see him? He's pressing the parable. He's drawing them in a little bit further. What's the owner going to do? Well, you don't know the end of it, imagine it. And what are you thinking? Well, aren't we ready to answer? Well, will someone sort out these scoundrels? And that was the conclusion of the religious leaders. After the Lord Jesus had given his question in verse 40, they answer in 31, he will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the fruits in their seasons. Wow. What a masterly way to preach and to teach. Lord Jesus here He was like Nathan the prophet in the Old Testament. There was a great king in the Old Testament called King David, the greatest king of Israel. And he'd done something very bad. He'd taken someone's wife, he'd committed adultery with her, and he had seen to the murder of the Sheba's husband. And David didn't bat an eyelid about it. Didn't really think about it. He just went on about his work. And a man came to him one day. He was a prophet. He was called Nathan. And Nathan told this little story. And he told a story about a very rich man who had some friends come for dinner. And he wanted to cook them lamb. Well, that'd be nice, wouldn't it? Maybe you've got that coming later on today. Well, we're not. We don't have any lamb. Sure we don't. It's chicken and beef. That's no lamb today. But this man, he wanted to do roast lamb. And he got a whole field full of sheep. But he went next door to a very poor man who got one pet lamb. He took his pet lamb, took it home, killed it, and offered it to his friends. And David, as he listened to Nathan the prophet, he was seething. How could he do that? And Nathan turned to him and said, "You are the man." And the Lord Jesus here is in the sandals of Nathan the prophet. And he's saying to these religious leaders, "You are the murdering men in the vineyard." This is the point in the parable where it's like a punch to the solar plexus. You see, these men had never thought of this. You see, they were thinking when they were listening to this parable. And they were thinking along these lines, most likely. You see, these Romans that have come and invaded our land, they're in the vineyard. And we need someone to kick them out. After all that they've done to the Lord's people. That's how they were thinking. They were thinking that the word of Jesus didn't apply to them. And we still do exactly the same. Some of us, putting my own hand up, don't have to put your hand up, but I've listened to sermons sometimes and I thought, oh, I wish somebody else had been there to hear that. Well, what about me? I was there. Did I hear it? Beware of that. Thinking the message would be for somebody else and not for me. Well, these men should have realized what the Lord Jesus was talking about. They sang Psalm 80 that we sang just 10 or 15 minutes ago. They sang it regularly in their worship. They knew that Israel was the vineyard. If you have time this afternoon, you can read Isaiah chapter 5. It's called Isaiah's Song. And in the prophecy of Isaiah, Israel is the vineyard, provided for God, cared for by God, instructed by God, kept by God, and God came looking for fruit, looking for grapes from his vineyard, of his vines, and Isaiah said that all that there was were these wild fruit that were useless. The Lord was looking for faith, devotion, commitment, and repentance. But what did the people of Israel do with God's servants, the prophets, whom the Lord sent regularly? They beat some, they killed some, and they stoned some. So what did the owner of the vineyard do? He sent his son. Now can you see it? And the son is right there. And he's telling these tenants of the vineyard this message. It's very powerful, isn't it? And he knew, the son knew exactly what these tenants in the vineyard were about to do to him. Take him out of the city and not beat him, but put him to death. And then the Lord Jesus, he just detonates this mighty explosive message on the laps of these men in verse 42. Jesus said to them, "Have you never read the scriptures?" Oh, that must have got them. These men said, you know, we love the scriptures. We've read them from cover to cover. We know them off by heart. Actually, they'd just been singing these scriptures. If you're following in your Bible, I don't think I put it in the order of service this way, but the Bible publishers put verse 42, or a good part of it, they indent it a little bit to show us it's a quotation. It's a quotation right out of Psalm 118, verse 42. Have you never read the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. They were singing this song going up to the Passover at this moment. Jesus said, you might have been singing it, but you weren't listening to it. These men were the ones who've been asking, by what authority? That's what the tenants were doing in the Lord's parable. And these men, even in their wicked rejection of Jesus Christ, God wasn't caught on the hop. He was sovereign over it all. That's why when you look at verse 43 and verse 44, although they're not indented by the publishers, these verses are quotes out of the Old Testament from Isaiah chapter 8 and Daniel chapter 2. Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you, away from you, and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. So can you see the irony? These rejectors of the Lord Jesus Christ, who question his authority, they're the very ones now who are confirming his authority as he brings them the word of God. Oh, how mighty is the Lord, that even the wicked serve his purposes. So there's the parable presented, and then there's the parable, and the Lord's pressing it on them. But now, it's not very rude, isn't it, to lift your this finger here. Now here's the parable poking us. Verse 45. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived he was speaking about them. They felt his finger on their chest. Oh, what love in the heart of Jesus Christ that he would press his finger on these men's heart. They hadn't shown fruit that God deserved and desired. After all his care for them, after giving them the scriptures, after giving them the prophets, after keeping them in the promised lands, they hadn't produced the fruits of love for the Lord, of repentance and following him. And how patient, how kind, that this same God sent his Son. And now the Lord says, now the Son says, because you religious leaders have not borne the fruit, this message is going to be taken from you and given to others. Now the Lord Jesus is not saying here that I'm done with the Jews and now the focus is going to be on Gentiles. As Reformed Christians at our churches, sometimes we're accused of a thing called replacement theology. You may not know it, but just in case you've ever heard of it, we don't believe that. We don't believe that the Gentile church just replaced the Jews. We believe what the scriptures tell us, that the Lord will build his church of converted Jew and converted Gentile. That's the pattern in the Old Testament. Not all who were of Israel were true Israelites. And the Lord was grafting in the ones and twos and Gentiles. When we come to the New Testament, the church is, with the enabling of the Spirit, goes out to the end of the earth. And he's bringing in Gentiles and Jews too. And some Christians would say there's going to be a time of great revival amongst Jews as well. However it is, the Lord is building his church of converted Jew and Gentile. And the Lord says to these men, there you are, and you've got this precious stone of me to build your life on, and you look at it and you say, nah. Just no good, that. And the Lord Jesus says, this stone you've rejected, It's become the capstone. And the church is being built on me from peoples from the ends of the earth. I will take it from you and give it to people producing its fruit. And that's a pattern that has happened all throughout history. It's happened in denominations, it's happened in congregations, it happens with individuals. Hearing yesterday of a minister who went to a church, and oh, they had a long-standing tradition in this church, and the church had just died away, and one or two, a handful of families, they weren't interested in the message that he brought. But God brought others who were interested in it and loved it. And this message that when the gospel of Jesus Christ is not received, God will still have his people. And he's building his church, happening in this island. Church buildings that were once full of people with names for generations, and they've all disappeared. But the pews aren't empty. Pews of men and women from all of the nations of the earth, because that's what Jesus Christ has promised to do. He will build his church. And if the people of East Belfast won't have it, if they won't have the fruits of belief and repentance and follow Jesus Christ, he'll take it away, this message, and he'll give it to others. Perhaps that's what he's doing. And we rejoice. We love it in our church when men and women from the nations of the earth come, and we see that the gospel has gone out to the world just as Jesus Christ has said it would. But this becomes very personal too. It becomes personal for you and for me to always make sure that we're not like these men. These men felt the finger of Jesus Christ on their hearts. They perceived that he was speaking about them. Them who hadn't borne the fruit, them who hadn't built their lives on him. But what did they do? Well, they feared the crowds, because the crowds knew he was a prophet. But they went on to seek to get rid of Jesus Christ. He's speaking about us, they said. Maybe as you listen today, maybe some of you are saying, he's speaking about me, because I've had this message and the Lord has provided so much in my life. I've heard this gospel. I've got a Bible. I know people who've been converted and come to Jesus Christ. But so far, I've been looking at this stone and I haven't been building my life on him. Well, if you feel his finger in your heart today, fall before him, turn from your sin, ask him to be your savior, and follow him. You see, the alternative is so awful, and I must tell you it, because it's right there in the words of Jesus Christ in verse 44. He says to these men who chucked the stone of foundation away, he said, the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. It was the Lord Jesus warning these men and women, these men as he was speaking to here, and anyone who'd hear, to reject Jesus Christ is the greatest sin in this world. You do know that. We like to categorize sin and say, well, this is a really big sin. All the things that are happening in our society and all the changes that there are to this, what terrible sins these are. Well, do you know that the Lord Jesus said there's a more terrible thing than the sins you think are terrible? It's the sin of unbelief. And here is the outcome for unbelief. It is the judgment of God that will fall and crush forever those who don't have the fruit of repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. So this parable today of the Lord Jesus is him opening his arms and saying, come and build your life in me. Come and turn from your sin and follow me. Come and have fruit in your life. have meaning and purpose and enjoy my blessing. He is speaking to us. Amen. Well, we're going to sing as we respond to God's word from the very words that the Lord Jesus was quoting. Psalm 118. That's one of the reasons we love singing the Psalms. Jesus sang them, and every one of them is filled with him. And he's the stone that we're seeing off here in verse 4. And he's the light that we're seeing off in verse 7. And he's the sacrifice that we're seeing in verse 17 as well. And think about this when you're seeing it. Jesus Christ himself sang these words, going up to Jerusalem to die, bind to the altar's horns with cords, me. Let me be the sacrifice, Father, for the sins of many. Psalm 118, 13 to 18, we'll sing God's praise.
This is the
Lord's own gift.
Blessed to all our lives, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of God the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.